Good afternoon and welcome. As president, it is my pleasure to formally call to order the 2106th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Our event today is a Jonathan F. Fanton Lecture, named for my predecessor who served as president of the American Academy from 2014 to 2019. Jonathan has joined us virtually to participate in today's program, and I want to take this opportunity to acknowledge his outstanding stewardship of this institution. Today's event stems from initiatives that began during Jonathan's tenure. In 2018, under his leadership, the American Academy launched a project to explore the pathways and barriers to participation in our democracy and what it means to be a good citizen in the 21st century. The work of the Bipartisan Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship has only grown more essential since then, as a series of crises have deepened the cracks in our political culture. We are grateful to Jonathan for his prescience in recognizing the need for this effort and for his continued service as a member of the commission. That commission's final report, Our Common Purpose, Reinventing American Democracy for the 21st Century, was released in June 2020. The report offers 31 bold recommendations to help the nation emerge as a more resilient democracy by 2026. As we've begun the implementation phase of the project, it has been inspiring to see how many Americans from across the country are committed to improving the health of our democracy. We're so grateful to all who have joined us in this important work. Today's conversation on the rights and responsibilities inherent to American citizenship connects directly to the core questions that animated the Commission on Democratic Citizenship and led to the Our Common Purpose report. I look forward to exploring what it means to be a good citizen in the 21st century together and hope that today's discussion will help us all practice better citizenship in our own communities. I want to welcome our panelists, E.J. Dionne, María Teresa Kumar, and John Shattuck, all of whom you will be introduced to momentarily. I also want to thank our moderator, Danielle Allen, director of the J. Safra Center for Ethics at Harvard and a co-chair of the commission. Danielle is the model of a scholar patriot, working tirelessly to protect and promote the ideals that underpin our democratic system through her scholarship and, most recently, as a candidate for office herself. We're grateful to Danielle for her service and her example, and are glad she is here with us today. Danielle, let me turn things over to you.
Thank you so much, President Oxtoby. I truly appreciate your kind words and certainly your presiding over this important conversation. It's wonderful to be here to celebrate Jonathan Fanton's work and leadership for the Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship. And we have terrific panelists joining us today in this question of what does it mean to be an American? What does it mean to be a good citizen? The categories, the questions almost sound antique, and yet they are core to our ability to function together in our massive and multicultural, diverse and beautiful society. What does it mean to be a good citizen and a good civic participant? The category of role and engagement is broad. When we started the work of the commission, it really began because Jonathan Fanton sort of sent up a flare and said, who else out there thinks that we are in a red alert moment in our democracy? And for those of us he reached out to first, we all had our own moments of red alert. In my own personal case, my sense of the fragility, the failures of our democratic system really dates back to 2009. Always growing up, I had had a mixed sense of light and dark about our country, a sense of hope and optimism and pride in our accomplishments, but also clear-eyed focus on the limitations and failures. But in 2009, I lost my younger cousin, Michael, to a combination of mass incarceration and gun violence. That was a real turning point moment for me and did give me a bleaker view about where we are as a country and what it would mean for our democracy to get to a place where we don't leave people trapped in really situations that don't permit them the well-being and flourishing that our constitutional democracy promises. Another red alert came for me in 2013 when Congress had an approval rating of 9%. And as Jonathan made calls to people, he found red alerts all over the place, all kinds of people who said it's time for us to really dig deep and figure out what does a healthy democracy consist of. And at the end of the day, a democracy can't be anything other than the people who make it. So fundamentally, that question about what we need for the health of our democracy is a question about what it means for us to be citizens and civic participants, and to do that work together. fundamental to that is a set of rights. Those are benefits. We're supposed to get protection of our rights for our participation, and we earn those benefits by fulfilling a set of responsibilities. Rights and responsibilities, those are the core components of the social contract. So as we come together today to talk about this question, we are dusting off some old categories, some old ideas, but we are doing that because of their urgency in the present, as we have on us a pressing need to figure out, for a fresh start, a new reimagined, reinvented democracy, the question of what rights and responsibilities we have to each other and to the practice of democratic citizenship. We have incredible panelists here today, true leaders, leaders of both thought and practice. I will go ahead and share their bios, and then I will jump in with a single question to each, and then we'll bring everybody up together for a shared conversation. So I'm delighted to say we have with us today E.J. Dionne, a journalist for the Washington Post and senior fellow for the Brookings Institution. E.J. works at the intersection of journalism and scholarship with an expertise of community and civil society. Also expertise in US elections, politics, polling, faith-based initiatives, ideology, journalism, the role of religion in public life and public opinion, all at the heart of our current struggles. He's the author of several books, but for today's conversation, most importantly, a brand new book with democracy advocate Miles Rapaport. This book is called 100% Democracy, A Case for Universal Voting. We'll talk about it today. I'm also pleased to introduce María, Teresa, Kumar, the founding president of Voto Latino, a civic engagement organization that leverages youth, technology, social platforms, and influencers, and is responsible for registering more than 500,000 new voters. María Teresa is also an activist and social entrepreneur and an Emmy-nominated MSNBC contributor. She has been named as one of the top 100 creative minds by Fast Company, one of the 10 most influential Latinos by Hispanic Executive, and one of the 10 most influential women in DC by Elle. Then last but not least, glad to have with us John Shattuck. John is a professor of practice at the Fletcher School at Tufts University. He's a former senior fellow at the Carr Center for Human Rights Policy here at Harvard. And he served as US Assistant Secretary of State for Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor. In addition, John has been the Washington Director of the American Civil Liberties Union and a US Ambassador to the Czech Republic. He also has a new book, in his case, with co-authors Sushma Raman and Matthias Rissa. This book is called Holding Together, A Hijacking of Rights in America and How to Reclaim Them for Everyone. John is a master of thinking about rights and responsibilities, and so I will invite him to join me in the spotlight so we can kick off our conversation. Welcome, John. I think you and I, some years ago, had a conversation about rights and responsibilities, and I was very impressed at the fact, again, that you were grabbing hold of these two terms that often people want to sort of push off to the side and say, no, they have to be at the center of our thinking about what a healthy democracy consists of in the 21st century. You have a new book out called Holding Together. And in it, you tell a really powerful story about an America where actually we have large bipartisan majorities for some core values. This goes really against the grain of our current understanding of ourselves. We take ourselves to be so polarized. Can you fill us in on what you found about what Americans do think about the rights and responsibilities of citizenship?
Thank you, Danielle, very much. And a salute to you for your commitment to democracy and all the work that you've done, including in the political arena. So I greatly admire that. It's a pleasure to be on this panel, of course. Yes, we've written a book about our national values at a time that we're really in the process of searching for ways to hold the country together, which is the title of our book. Just a very brief word about history before I answer your question, which is that, as you said, we're a country of unprecedented diversity. We're built not, as other countries are, on common ancestry, but on successive waves of immigration, on enslavement, and on the subjugation of indigenous people. And Americans have really been thrown together by chance and exploitation, but they've been held together for a long time by a phrase that you find in the Declaration of Independence. a belief that all people are created equal and have rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We failed to implement those rights in many ways, but people have a deep belief in them. Now, of course, I don't think the country ever would have come together as a nation without that belief. So that, in a sense, is the core set of values that have been handed down for a long time. Now, of course, the founders of the country were an elite slice of the population. They were men, white men with property who had an exclusive view of rights, basically rights for white men of property. But this notorious exclusion has been challenged throughout American history. And I think the great struggle for equal rights, which is the struggle that we're talking about in our book, battles for the right to vote, to equal protection and equal opportunity, freedom of speech, religion, individual dignity, due process of law, and above all, a democratic form of government. These are these define what it is to be an American. So we wanted to find out in our book what actually Americans think today about their rights. And so we proceeded with a series of polls and town hall meetings. And we came up with some remarkable data, which frankly, we were surprised at. 80% across the political spectrum said that, quote, without our rights, America is nothing. Now, of course, rights have very different meanings for different people. They can cause conflicts. We certainly know that when a conflict between the right you may claim not to wear a mask and the white right that I claim to be protected from COVID, which is a kind of contemporary version of these sets of conflicts. But in spite of the conflicts, our polls show that 80% said that they believe Americans have more in common than many people think. So this is kind of remarkable. It's at odds with the division and extremism that we see all around us. And we're obviously going to explore that here today. But I think if you dig deeper in our polls, and let me give you just a little bit more data, you find that, in fact, the possibility of bridging some of these divisions exists because a majority of Americans agree that rights carry responsibilities. They must be balanced with responsibilities. 8 out of 10 people agree that personal freedom should be balanced against a responsibility to keep people safe in a pandemic. 8 out of 10 agree that the police can protect the public from crime while also being held responsible for their own crimes. And 7 out of 10 agree that the U.S. should have automatic voter registration, or as E.J. and his colleagues write in their book, universal voting to reinforce the right and responsibility to vote. So there's a lot going on here that is counterintuitive, if you will, given the circumstances that we face in the country today of deep polarization. The bottom line, and there's a lot of polling data in our book, of course, is that a majority of Americans have an expansive view of equal rights and see those as the core values of the country, the values that determine what it is to be an American. But this silent majority, which is really made up of a very wide range of people, Democrats, independents, Republicans, even some Trump voters, disagree on specific issues, but have a common commitment. They have the potential to hold the country together, but their diversity really keeps it keeps them from being politically cohesive. And so they are overshadowed by an active minority that's working to polarize people. This minority is made up of a mostly white constituency motivated by fear, a base that denies the equal rights of others they regard as threats to their racial, cultural, and political identity. So they're attacking American values, and they're doing that in two dimensions that I'll mention, and then I'll turn it over to your question for others. Now, first, they're doing it in the area of the electoral process, of course, where we are finding attacks on the basic propositions of voting rights. 35 new state laws have been adopted by 19 states over the last year, which would weaken or restrict or put burdens on the right to vote in various ways. But our polls show that a majority of Americans want to strengthen, not weaken, the right to vote. 87%, including 80% of Republicans, actually favor national standards to protect the electoral process. 84% favor the Justice Department reviewing voting regulations to make sure they aren't racially discriminatory. And 82%, including 55% Republicans, favor increased early voting to promote maximum participation. So as we see, there's a disconnect between the polling, the information that we have about what the underlying values are that Americans feel continue to have, and the activities that are going on in the highly polarized political arena. And I know we'll get into this more, so I will not say more about the polarization at the moment, but I wanted to just put forth the basic data that we've produced in the book to show where this disconnect begins.
Thank you so much, John. So you've given us a picture of hope there. Maybe we actually agree on more than we think we do. And you've raised some questions about the disconnect between a sort of center of gravity of opinion in the country and what our policies are. So we'll come back to that disconnect. We will dig into it. But let me actually turn over the question to EJ Dionne. John just articulated sort of a hope that this big silent supermajority that he's saying is out there. We're going to probe that one. We're going to test it and see if it holds water. Hope that their voices could be brought to the surface and could really lead and guide our politics. You have just published a really extraordinary and controversial book, which has the job of trying to make sure everybody's voice is truly heard in our politics. In 100% democracy, you argue that voting shouldn't just be something we think of as a right, and it shouldn't even just be something that we think of as a moral obligation. It should be an actual legal duty. We should be required to vote, every single one of us, just like jury duty. Now, you're crazy. You're crazy. Why should we want that? Tell us why we should take this unprecedented step.
I love that way of introducing it. I just want to say a couple of things first. One is, it's a real honor to be with you, Danielle. I admire you for so many things and all of your writing, but I really admire you for jumping into the political fray. And I just want to make a point to you, which is three of our last five presidents, Obama and Bush and Clinton, had a race in their lives, an election race that didn't turn out the way they intended, and they became president. So you are now fully qualified to become president of the United States. So God bless you.
Like I said, you're crazy. Okay.
Yeah, all right. God bless you for doing that. And it's a real honor to be with John and María Teresa, who everybody knows are really smart and thoughtful and engaged, but they are actually really nice and decent people, which may be more precious in this world. So it's great to be with you guys. And I want to thank the Academy for hosting this session and also for their extraordinary report on American democracy and a whole set of reforms that are really valuable. And they include the idea that Miles Rappaport and I, Miles was part of that group, and that María Teresa worked on with us, Norm Ornstein, who was part of that, has worked on this with us. Yes, and we have the notion that that rights and responsibilities reinforce each other. Often when people talk about rights and responsibilities, they often seem to think that responsibilities somehow limit the rights or qualify the rights. What we argue is that certainly in the case of voting, the best way to defend the right is to assert the legal responsibility of everyone to vote. Let me just parenthetically say that we call it universal voting and not compulsory voting for a very specific reason, which is nothing in our proposal requires anyone to vote for anyone. In our proposal is largely modeled after Australia's system, although there are 24 democracies that have versions of our idea, and many of them have made it work very well. But Australia is really the ultimate proof of concept. They've had it for 100 years and it's worked extremely well. And if 100 years isn't a good enough proof of concept, I don't know if we'll ever get one. And under our system, in Australia's system, you are required to participate, not to pick a candidate. If you don't like anybody on the list, you don't have to vote. You could write in Danielle Allen or María Teresa or John Shattuck's name. You can scrawl something on the ballot. And just to make sure that this is not compelled speech, We would also add a none of the above option to the ballot, which is exists actually now in Nevada and Arizona. What the core idea here is that American elections have become like fancy dinner parties, that you have an A list of likely voters, and then a B list of people who are registered but don't vote that much, and a C list of people who haven't been able to register. By the way, that group bulks large among young people because our voting system is very unfriendly to young people who move around a lot more than older people do. And with that dinner party kind of election, politicians spend almost all their time appealing to that A-list, the likely voters, which means they spend a lot of time trying to turn out their base. And as my friend Miles likes to say, that often means campaigns based on enrage to engage, just to pull people out. But they also spend a lot of time trying to depress the other side's base, legally these days, and I'll get to that. But even in the campaign itself, just to discourage people from voting for their own party's candidate, this leads to campaigns that are needlessly divisive. Now, Miles and I, A, do not pretend our idea will fix everything that ails the system, nor do we think political campaigns will all be peaceable kingdoms. Candidates will go after each other. But we believe this dinner party system we have actually aggravates divisiveness, aggravates the tendency to be negative. And a lot of the voters who don't vote are people who are less ideological. So this system might actually produce not a somewhat more moderate electorate in spirit. That seems to be what it does in Australia. I too have a favorite part of the Declaration of Independence for our purposes. The founders declared that the legitimate government depends upon the consent of the governed. They didn't say the consent of two-thirds of the governed, which was our excellent turnout rate by our standards in the 2020 election. They didn't say 50% of the governed, which is what we got in the high turnout midterm election of 2018. They said the governed. That means all of us. But the other side of this, and I'll just close here, Miles and I have been talking about this now for weeks, and so I could go on, but I won't. We think that at a time when there are active efforts to make it harder to vote, asserting voting as a duty sends a signal to every part of the political system that the obligation of that system is to make it as easy as possible for people to carry out their duty. And so we do argue that we would need a variety of what we call gateway reforms to make sure it's easy for everyone to vote. One of my great research assistants, Amber Hurley, was looking at all the ways Australia makes it easy for people to register to vote. And she came running into my office and said, look at all this cool stuff Australia does to make participation easier. We can do that as well. Right now, we're becoming two Americas on voting. 25 states have expanded access since the great expansions during the pandemic. 19 states have pulled back access. We want to be one America, indivisible and fully participating. And I'll close just by mentioning jury duty, because that's another area where the right and the responsibility reinforce each other. One of the greatest victories of the civil rights movement was to end discrimination against Black Americans in jury service, to allow Black Americans to serve on juries. But remember what that victory really meant. And Charles Ogletree, the great scholar at Harvard and civil rights activist, has pointed this out. That meant that Black Americans, like white Americans, would be compelled to serve on juries. That is a form of compulsion that increases freedom, that increases fairness, that increases the justice of our system, because everyone is included. And we think everybody should be included in our election process.
Perfect. Thank you so much, EJ. And thank you for mentioning that the Our Common Purpose report includes an endorsement of universal voting as one of its recommendations. So this is the report the Academy put out in June of 2020, and the 31 recommendations for securing the health of our democracy, reinventing the practice of democratic citizenship. And indeed, Universal voting was one of those key 31 recommendations. So we will.
If somebody can put it in the chat, by the way, for people to see, it's a great report. You guys did great work.
Perfect. Thank you so much. We will make sure that gets into the chat. And we will come back to this question of if we have this supermajority with a commitment to voting and we have a mechanism to get everybody's voice in and to really achieve universal voting, you know, why don't we get there? What are the obstacles to change? We will come back to that conversation, but I would like to invite María Teresa to join us and to share her perspective on this question. You are an advocate for voting rights. You have increased people's participation in voting. You have deep knowledge and expertise of the experience of Latinx communities, both in facing hurdles to voting and finding ways to overcome those hurdles. So I'd be really grateful for you to share your perspective here. When does it help for us to talk about voting as a responsibility and as a duty? Is that a useful thing? And what do you think about the prospect of going all the way to a mandate for voting to make it truly universal?
Well, Danielle, first of all, thank you so much for the conversation. I think that it is timely because we do feel that there was an assault on our democracy and our institutions. And Danielle, perhaps you did one of the most bravest things, and that was putting your hat in the ring. And I have to remind folks that it's not just about running, but it's about finding really great candidates for them to run as well, because that's how we change the equation. And EJ, anytime EJ calls, I listen, and he invited me kindly to join him and Miles Rappaport in the Universal Voting Task Force. And it was something that I deeply cared about. And through that journey, I was sold, I think in a matter of seconds, about this idea of universal voting, EJ. Our biggest challenge was making sure that people of color and poor people in general were not penalized for not exercising it. So that was where our big discussion was. And John, thank you for the conversation, but more importantly, for being brave enough to have it in a time when people are polarized. I would actually say that there is few of us that are polarized. A lot of us are a silent majority, our challenges are oftentimes that the person who screams the loudest is the one that gets amplified. And so we are having oftentimes asymmetrical conversations, EJ, that you mentioned before. Something to clarify about our work, we actually have registered 1.2 million voters in this last election, according to Tufts University report, where everybody audits our work, not just us, but the collective we in the movement. Voto Latino registered over 650,000 voters. 56% of them were first-time voters. And equally as important, 57% of them had less than a college education. And so we did what is really hard to do, was to get people excited from the people that are oftentimes more apathetic to government. We are officially the largest direct voter registration outfit in the country for online, and we're the second largest voter registration in the country, second only to the Voter Participation Center. I say this only because it's taken 18 years of a long time experiment to convince people that if we target young Latinos and we talk to them and tell them that they belong in this space, that they do listen. And one of the things that we have found, Danielle, to answer your question, is that when we directly talk to individuals in the Latinx community and young voters as a whole, and we create a space where they can ask questions, where we can tell them that you don't need a degree, that this democracy is theirs, they do start paying attention and participating. We are living in a time when someone is trying to tell them that the government that they are trying to participate in doesn't look like them. So how do we change that equation? And that is by voting and running for office, such as yourself. I've been doing a lot of reporting recently on what's happening in Ukraine. And one of the things I found most fascinating was that the parliamentarians that they kept talking, on MSNBC and CNN, one seemed younger than the next, EJ and John and Danielle. And so I finally asked the question, is like, what's the average age of a Ukrainian parliamentarian outside of the president? It turned out that it was 46. They are representing a rising generation that is not just true in Ukraine, but worldwide and true in the United States. And so if we do talk about this idea of universal voting, it is bringing in the largest generation of Americans who happen to be the most diverse group of Americans who happen to be Generation Z into the fold. And you're starting to see what that means when they do run for office and when they do participate. They're talking about intersectional issues that make older folks uncomfortable, but that is their lived experience and allows us to make monumental change. I often say, Danielle, that I don't have to convince a young person that climate change is real. I just have to convince them that the system works if they elect elected officials that reflect their values. And so for us, universal voting is an opportunity for us to convince people about participation. But really, frankly, I'm very proud of the 1.2 million people that Voto Latino has registered. But if we're to level with everybody, Voto Latino should not be in the business of registering voters. That's a government function. Our charge should be convincing people for the policies that will make their life different. But now we have to do two things. And actually, since our evolution at Voto Latino, we have now started doing three things. Our first in 2004, when we first started, our job was just to register voters. Our second, after the gutting of the Voting Rights Act, we had to explain to people how they can make their vote count. And now with the onslaught of over 400 pieces of legislation trying to prevent people from voting, we physically now have to sue states. We're suing the state of Texas, we've sued the state of Florida, we've sued the state of Arizona, of Colorado. That should not be our charge. But because there is a group of individuals of one party that are significantly trying to repress the vote, we would be not doing our function in advocating for democracy in our voter if we allow not to actually get into that fight. And so universal voting, I am sold on it because I do believe that of everything, I think a lot of people are tired of politics because of the volume of the people on both sides that turn people off. But providing universal voting, you get everybody in and you actually have, you go back to a place where of negotiating for the best policy possible. That takes patience and it takes time, but it allows us to actually address the fundamental issues that we're facing in this country. These other issues that we have that are cultural issues are nonsense, because they are preventing us from actually getting to the root of the real pain and the real hurt that a lot of Americans are facing in this time, especially coming out of COVID. And so that's why I believe that universal voting is not, it's not the end all, but it is definitely a modernization mechanism to meet the 21st century.
So thank you so much. You've put a lot of really rich material on the table for our conversation. I'd like to invite EJ and John back to join us here. And I'm gonna sort of pick up the conversation on two planks. I'm going to pick up first a piece that's specific to universal voting, and then we will come back to this big hard problem of polarization and the asymmetrical question and so forth. But to start on universal voting, so I'm with you. It's a beautiful idea, and I can see all the incredible virtues. You know, no more money spent on keeping other people's voters from voting. You know, reduce the negative advertising. Turn voting into a holiday, be Australia, embrace all these ease of access measures for participation. But then there's this other thing that comes gnawing at me, which is the simple fact, and you alluded to this, María Teresa, that currently turnout is the lowest for communities of color. And communities of color are also the communities most overburdened by too many laws, too much enforcement. What? You're going to add another one? You know, and just increase the number of fines and fees that communities of color find themselves fighting their way through. And I know you all thought about this question, so I'm just putting it out there really bluntly so we can hear what answers you came to as a part of your task force work. And María Teresa, maybe I'll start with you on that.
You know, it's interesting because one of the outrages early on when they were passing these voter restrictions in 2021, after all 50, let's remind everybody, all 50 states certified a fair, free election. And that's when they decided they were going to add more restrictions. One of the things that I took umbrage with was when people were saying, can you believe they can't pass water out to people waiting in line? And I'm like, that's the wrong question. Why are people waiting in line? And by creating a space for universal voting, you all of a sudden take the onus of how to run an effective, efficient election back into the Secretary of State and local election officials. Their charge is now we need to create efficient voting so that everybody can vote. And so some of that time tax that currently so many communities of color experience will diminish as a result. Because all of a sudden they will get these local elected officials will actually get resourced appropriately for every citizen to participate. That's one. I think the other thing that EJ highlighted, which is equally important, is that we're not forcing you to vote for someone. We're asking you to show up, and ideally on a holiday, so you could actually register your grievance or your support. And that allows communities to be welcomed. One of the reasons, and this has been years of research at Voto Latino, there are two reasons that young Latinos and Latinos in general don't register and don't vote. One is no one's asking them. And two, they don't feel that they're smart enough on the issues. In this case, the democracy is demanding it. So it allows that that conversation. And then it also allows the conversations like, well, I know I have to vote. What should I get to do, right? And so at Voto Latino, one of the things that we do is we provide people with crib sheets because we recognize that our communities are overburdened and overworked and overtaxed. So we actually try to say, well, you tell us what you care for. And we work with Ballot Ready, which is a nonpartisan organization. And then based on what they have said, the issues they care about, it helps them navigate it. So there are tools to help navigate the second, but this idea of making, again, the onus on the government to make sure that just like everybody has to file their taxes and the government makes sure that you file your taxes, there are ways to do the exact same thing for good.
That's a metaphor I would not recommend using.
but it's efficient, right? No, but it allows the government does have capacity to do these big, large things. Why not when it comes to modernizing our electoral systems?
No, I do appreciate the argument you're making, Maria Teresa. And I just want to underscore one really important point, which is that you are really making the case that a universal duty, what that then generates is an invitation, a consistent invitation to every single person. We currently do not have a system that formally invites everybody to participate. And I think when one registers, that what you're talking about is an invitation to every single person. That's very powerful and very, very compelling. EJ, you wanted to add something.
Yeah, so whenever Richard Nixon was asked a question he didn't want to have asked, he'd say, I'm glad you asked that question. In this case, I really am glad you asked that question because it is an issue we really struggle with. Miles and I and many members of the group met with a whole lot of civil rights groups. And by the way, among other groups, the NAACP has endorsed this idea. There are a lot of civil rights groups who have endorsed this idea precisely because they see it as tearing down barriers and inviting everybody in. But we were very, very concerned with what has come to be called the Ferguson problem, where low-income people, particularly low-income people of color, end up having penalties and fines piled on top of them, and then those fines become criminalized. And so they are burdened by the fine, and then they are burdened by the potential of criminal action against them. We want our system to have nothing to do with that. We refer to it as much more a nudge than a shove or a hammer. Under our system, the fine in Australia's system, the fine is $15 Australian, which is about $20 Australian, which is about $15 American. If you don't vote, you get a little notice in the mail. You say, why couldn't you vote? If you give any sort of reasonable excuse, they don't fine you. Only about 13% of Australians even have to pay the fine. We would imagine a similar thing would be true of our system. But we make very clear that this fine is not criminal. It can't be compounded. No interest. It's $20 one time, period. And that if you can't pay it or don't want to pay it, you can pay it with an hour of community service. So we really are trying to push that aside. But we also in the book talk about possible incentives to vote. And I know Congresswoman Ayanna Presley has been, I don't know if she's introduced it yet, but I know she's very interested in the idea of creating a tax credit for everybody who registers to vote, $100 or $50, say, if you register to vote, it's refundable, so it goes to everyone. If you actually did something like a tax credit, you do it to register, not to vote, by the way, so you don't run afoul anti-bribery laws. There's a real debate about whether you can actually provide tax credits for actual voting. In that case, you wouldn't even be, somebody would be simply giving back part of their tax credit for not completing the deal by voting. But we go out of our way in this proposal to say, we don't want it to add to these problems that already exist. And I think a well-designed system could do that.
No, I appreciate that. Well, I'll throw out one more idea for you while you're noodling on different approaches. If indeed the onus then is on our governmental institutions to ensure universal participation. So let's find the secretaries of state. Let's find the parties as institutions of state government who should have the job of turning everybody out. anyway, just another way of...
No, I do think the obligation to register people to vote, it should be initially a state obligation. Yep. I agree with that. Now, under Australia's system, you got the responsibility to make sure you're on the rolls. But the government, 96% of people in Australia are registered. And you do need a good system. And by the way, making our election system nonpartisan, I mean, I think we may be the only country in the world that has a partisan system of running elections. Yep. Which seems an odd idea when you think about it for a few minutes.
Yep. Now, John.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. I'm going to be the civil libertarian here because I think it's important that somebody actually present this point of view, even though I'm not sure totally that I agree with it. You know, burdening people with a right, that is to say, mandating that you exercise that right, is oxymoronic in many ways. It is not a right. So I think my approach to this topic is that there are many things that need to be done. Above all, automatic registration, as I said earlier, which is a very popular, about 75% of the people that we polled are interested in that. Another 82% are interested in national standards for voting in order to assure that there is voting integrity, et cetera. But I think, and we didn't ask this question directly, but I suspect if the question were asked, do you believe in universal mandatory voting, I think the numbers would go down significantly. Now, that's my civil liberties objection is partly a matter of principle. But as I stated it earlier, I think there is really a concern here that if you're burdening something that is otherwise a constitutional right, that itself is problematic from a constitutional standpoint. I don't think that necessarily will hold up. But I do think that you don't want to give arguments to the opponents who are saying that this whole electoral apparatus is essentially one big giant government program that is one more thing that's burdening the American people, because that is itself a cause of the polarization in the country today. So I think that point of view at least needs to be expressed. Having said all of that, as I've told EJ personally and Miles as well, you know, I'm personally in favor of really moving up to the as close to the actual mandate as we can get. I would oppose putting it in terms of a mandate, and I think I would oppose all of these various small fines and other mechanisms that you were describing earlier for the reasons that I've just stated.
Two quick points. One, our own polling shows right now, I always joke that Miles and I are either the most honest book writers or the most foolish book writers, because our own polling shows that right now only about a quarter of Americans support our idea. So we have a ways to go. On the other hand, 61% of Americans, equal in both parties, believe that voting is both a right and a duty. But to John's point, I would ask him back, so should we abolish the requirement that people serve on juries if they're called? Should we abolish the requirement that parents educate their kids until they are at least 16 years old? Is the obligation to serve on a jury a violation of your civil liberties?
No, actually, I would distinguish the jury duty from voting. Voting is a constitutional right, the right to vote. One has that vote, that right. Serving on a jury is an obligation of citizenship that we've decided, the country's decided, can be imposed on citizens. I think in favor of your point that maybe it's equivalent is that we've accepted it over time. It's turned out to be quite reasonable. And even with penalties exacted against people who don't show up for jury service. But I still would distinguish between being a person who's called upon as a civic duty, an obligation of citizenship to serve on a jury, and someone who says, I have a right to vote, but I'm damned if I want the government to tell me that I have to vote.
But I think we could go back and forth like this. I just want to underline that I really think they are equivalent. The obligation to serve on a jury, as Ogletree and others have written, undergirds the right to a fair trial. No universal jury service, no fair trial. Then we think that the obligation to help shape the future of your country in an election is as important a civic duty as serving on a jury. And if you make voting as convenient as it should be, it's actually far less of a burden. We want people to be able to vote by mail. We want people to be able to vote in the easiest way possible. So we think this demand, with the tiniest of fines, easily waived, makes perfect sense for what is also a fundamental duty of citizenship. But we will, right now, we have a selling job to do, because there are a lot of people who say something along the lines of what you say, John. And that's why we try to make it a nudge and not a shove or a hammer.
So I'm going to jump in here and pull us in the direction of another question that you each put on the table in pieces and parts that we haven't addressed frontally. And that is, John, coming back to your original argument, you gave us a picture of a supermajority of Americans committed strongly to a right to vote, whether they think that's mandatory, universal voting, just universal voting, a little unclear, but nonetheless, strong, powerful commitment. And yet we have, in your account, a minority driving polarization and division. Several of you have referenced the challenge of polarization as an obstacle to achieving change. So I'd love to have you each just sort of share, you know, in relatively brief remarks, if you don't mind, your sort of thoughts about polarization and what it really does tell us about where we are in our politics right now. Then we'll open it up to audience Q&A. And please, folks, use the Q&A function on your screens to put some questions in the Q&A, and we'll come to your questions once we've tackled this small topic.
Well, let me just put three or four things very quickly out as bullet points here, and then others can take them apart or amplify them. Why polarization? What is going on? Where did this come from? I think, and just to be very provocative, it is heavily coming from a political wing. It is not necessarily a partisan wing, but it is a very dangerous wing of our electorate that is determined to divide people. And it's determined to divide people, and particularly about their rights. And we want to deny others' rights that we have, because they are threats to us in various and sundry ways, whether it's economic or above all racial threats or identity threats or what have you. The second point is the spread of disinformation in the world that we live in. It's extremely easy to propagate all kinds of disinformation, as we know, through social media, et cetera. And what we've just been through with the big lie and the election, the claim of election fraud, unanimously rejected by 80 judges across the country and virtually all nonpartisan voting officials. That's an example of the kind of polarization that exists when this kind of fraud can be put forward in such a broad way. Then the politics of grievance, which again are practiced by primarily this minority that I'm talking about. You know, when President Trump attacked the press as enemies of the people, that's essentially putting an open season on the media for a lot of people who were listening to him one way or another. I also think there are structural issues, party primaries that promote extremism, primaries that punish moderates because they're seen not to be sufficiently extreme within the framework that's being put forward, because it's primarily extreme sides that participate in primaries. And then finally, the winner-take-all election system that we now have, which essentially freezes a lot of voters out of the results. So those are a number of factors that I think have been a major contribution to polarization.
All right. No, thank you for sharing that, John. EJ, would you like to add your take?
Sure. Two points. One is just a basic point, which is the polarization is in part the product of partisanship overlapping much more tightly with our various other identities than it used to. Party identification overlaps more than ever with race, with religion, with the type of community you live in, metro versus small town, rural. And it turns out it looks like from a lot of data, we are more likely to live near people who agree with us because of these overlapping identities. So there is that kind of structural thing. But I think there is a name for this mysterious group that John just described. That name is the right wing of the Republican Party. And I am with my colleagues Tom Ann and Orm Ornstein, who have written about this for years, that right now polarization is asymmetric. It doesn't mean there isn't a left wing of the Democratic Party and a right wing of the Republican Party, but by every measure, the Republican Party as a whole has moved well to the much more to the right of center than the Democratic Party has moved to the left of center. Now, this doesn't mean that all Republicans are extremists. If you look at the nominees of the Republican Party, say in 2008 or 2012, John McCain and Mitt Romney, they were fairly mainstream people. They were conservative, but mainstream people. And yet this rising right wing in the Republican Party was present in those primaries. And so that's what I am in John's excellent book with Sushma and Matthias. You find a lot of areas where people who call themselves Republican agree with people who call themselves Democratic on a slew of issues. But the fact that this cultural right wing, it's especially it's motivated by the cultural right and funded by the economic right, in a sense, this right wing really makes it impossible for a lot of that rank and file that might be more complicated in its views to express itself in our politics. And so I think having a functional center-right party again is an essential cure, essential building block to healing our polarization. It doesn't mean I vote for them or agree with them. I'm more on the progressive side of politics, but I have a lot of respect for center-right people who believe in democracy and fair elections and access to the ballot. And I wouldn't fear their election. I'd just probably try to vote them out of office the next time. But I am genuinely worried and afraid about the nature of this right wing that is too powerful right now in the Republican Party.
María, Teresa, I mean, you were talking earlier before we came on to the webinar with everybody about sort of disconnect between the parties and the rest and people. We'd love to have you expand on that distinction, why you think it's an important distinction, how it relates to this conversation.
So one of the few things that, first of all, there's so many things that I what John mentioned, I think he's absolutely right when we're talking about the place we're in. And EJ is also, I think, hitting the nail on the head as far as there is an extremism with the party. And part of it is because when you do polls, just on voting, for example, and you ask individuals, Republican, Democratic, Independent, whether or not they believe that everybody should have access to the voting booth, overwhelmingly, it's a yes. And it is one of the few issues that actually cuts through party lines. And that, that gives me pause, and you take a look back and saying, well, who are the culprits? And part of one of the things that, and I think John, you were alluding to it, was consumption of media and who is putting people, who is firing them up. There was recently a study that was done that revealed they basically paid individuals that watched Fox News $10 to $15 to watch CNN. And then pull them to see if their minds changed. And that exposure to more analytical media actually had the individuals that were consuming that CNN to change their minds, to see a different worldview. Sadly, once the money was exhausted, those individuals went back to watching Fox News, but that means that they probably like that. But it gives you an example of what media is doing to help polarize and reinforce these terrible ideas of who fellow Americans are. And I would argue that one of the reasons we are in this state of polarization has everything to do with a growing multicultural America, that instead of talking about using our multiculturalism as an asset, we are diving deeply into racism, which is our Achilles heel. I say this because the gutting of the Voting Rights Act, the most underreported fact was that Shelby County had experienced a 297% increase in the Latino population in 2010. If you follow the 3 months after the gutting of the Voting Rights Act, 22 jurisdictions basically lifted the efforts to protect the vote, all of them, all 22, had experienced at least a 90% increase in the Latino population, according to the 2010 census. For the second decade in a row, you have Latinos accounting for 52% of the Latino of the American population growth, American born. The difference in 2010 versus 2020 was in 2010, the majority of those Latinos were under the age of 18. And in 2020, they are actually eligible to vote. And so when we're talking about birtherism, when we're talking about the big lie, when we're talking about these big meaty issues that are facing that challenge our democracy, all of them lead to a multicultural America that's vastly different from the people that right now that are occupying most elected offices. And so what encourages me is that in 2020, we had the most Americans that ever participated in an election. And the multicultural America, the Black, white, Asian, African-American, gay, straight, who voted in favor of democracy and against an autocratic government, was the one that won out. And what gives me encouragement is that there's so many millions of them, of us turning 18, that we have to make sure that we're preparing them so that they too could participate. And I'll just leave it here. By 2022, by this midterm, we're expecting an additional 6 million more young voters that are going to be eligible to vote. 2/3 of them are young people of color. How do we make sure that they see themselves in this democracy?
So I'm going to bring in some questions from the Q&A at this point, and I'm going to sort of combine a couple of questions here. First, I just want to note a suggestion from the chat from Donna Shalala that if the goal is universal participation, maybe we should put also letting 16-year-olds vote, lower the voting age to 16 on the table. So I just want to throw that out there into the conversation. But there are several questions that are really focused on the issue of how we all get ready to vote anyway in the first place, issues of voter education, information ecosystems, misinformation, and the like. And I think the question is really, let's just say we wave a magic wand, we've got universal voting, everybody participates. What else do we actually need in the sort of infrastructure of our democracy, our civic infrastructure, so to speak, so that that voting can be a productive, healthy process and experience? María, Teresa, let me go ahead and invite you to weigh in on that first.
First of all, welcome, Donna. I do think that, first of all, there's various things, but in California, for example, California is my home state. When we first started Voto Latino, we did a lot of work there. Secretary Alex Padilla, a good friend, came in and basically allowed for pre-registration at 16 years old. I can tell you now that Voto Latino doesn't need to run a program at scale. Our work now is encouraging people to turn out. That's a very different function. And so one, it does work because it's inviting people to the conversation. I think oftentimes we fail to realize that there is modernization taking place at the state level. So how do we make sure that it is translated to the federal level so that everybody gets to reap those benefits? But I do think that it requires also a deeper analysis of what are the systems that are preventing people from participation and getting a better understanding on what those metrics are. But at the same time, again, going back to the states that are doing excellent job and applying them to federal laws. We don't necessarily need to look outside our borders for all the solutions. Some of them are actually being quite dynamic right here at home.
Right, so there's another interesting thought that, you know, universal pre-registration of 16-year-olds might be the most efficient stepping stone to universal voting, in fact. So a policy idea that we could all keep in mind. EJ, do you have thoughts on the issues around information, media ecosystems, voter education and the like?
A couple of things. First, we missed Donna Shalala here in DC. I am very sorry you're not still here, but I hope you're doing well. Thank you for the question. Second, Miles and I in our book very much support pre-registration, and we love to link it actually with expanded civic education in the schools. The schools Our kids all took the AP federal, state, and local government class. It's a great class that could easily be generalized to the entire population. And I've noticed, it's purely anecdotal, that a lot of the students who took that class, now maybe some of it's self-selecting, but they seem to stay engaged in politics in a way and took it seriously. And so I think that could be generalized. We have all kinds of reasons to want to abolish the Electoral College. One of them is to make somebody's vote matter. Because if you live in Massachusetts or Utah or Idaho or Vermont, you might well make a calculation that your vote will not affect the presidential election and you might not choose to vote down ballots. I think there are a million reasons to abolish the Electoral College. And as the population moves around, it's increasingly out of sync with where people actually live. I think the number is 70% of us will live in 15 states by 2040. That's gonna wreak havoc with the popular vote in the Electoral College. Lastly, and I won't say a lot about this, people should take a look at my Washington Post colleague, Margaret Sullivan's great book on this. There are all kinds of reasons to worry about the media and Fox News. I am desperately worried about the decline of local media. That certain national newspapers can figure out how to turn a profit on the basis of subscriptions because their subscription base is national and international. We have all sorts of great local papers just going out of business. Local papers help build community. Local papers help keep state and local politicians accountable and all kinds of other local institutions accountable. I think there are ways with foundations, with changes in the tax law, and other things we could do. We desperately need to strengthen local media because if we lose it, our democracy is in big trouble.
Well, let me take that as an opportunity to plug the Our Common Purpose report again. We have recommendations that are about supporting regrowth of local journalism and some good ideas there for how to work on that. And I think the Our Common Purpose report also has a response on the Electoral College question, although it's a different one. It's the alternative solution of increasing the size of the House and getting back to a place where the size of the House changes over time and allocations of representatives as demographic patterns change. So throwing that out there for all you.
I love that idea too. The House hasn't grown forever.
For 100 years, exactly. Yeah. Yes. No, it's time to let the House grow. Here we go. Another slogan for us. I'm going to close with one last question. I'll ask each of you to answer it. We'll go Johnny, Jay, and Maria, Teresa, the way we started again. It's a powerful and moving question and a hard one, but you have just each about a minute, okay? So I am afraid for the 2024 election, one person writes. What should a concerned citizen be doing proactively to try to optimize a good democratic experience, neutralizing the poison that, quote, our elections do not work? So what can a concerned citizen proactively do to try to make sure that the people around them have a good democratic experience so that we can have confidence in our elections? It's a deep and important question. John?
It is. It's certainly an important question, and there's certainly no one answer. I think above all, the things that we're talking about here are what citizens can do. They certainly can vote, and they may even, if EJ and Miles are successful, they may be mandated to vote. Although I want them to vote no matter what, and also to really get more information. I think there are various ways in which citizens can participate now in pushing for more information. There's for example, there's certainly an effort right now to understand better how the disinformation comes out of the social media and gets promulgated so widely. And the very specific effort there, which is very much supported in our polls, is to require that social media platforms provide their algorithms for general inspection so we understand better how it is that people are getting targeted and how information is getting out there in a much broader way. Now, that's complicated. Obviously, it's not something that everybody can simply roll up their sleeves and do, but it is partly, there is an appropriate social media regulation movement to which people can in which people can participate. There are also various other kinds of reforms that people could throw their themselves behind. One is to develop what we call ranked choice voting, which we haven't mentioned yet in this conversation. And ranked choice voting really is a way of trying to moderate and get more moderate candidates by actually having a series of choices so that a person who's voting actually can rank the candidates that they're voting for. So you don't simply, it's not an in or out situation. You say this is number one, two, or three, or four. And this is now being adopted by a wide number of jurisdictions, particularly at the local level, at the city level. Those are a number of ideas. I think above all, what a concerned citizen can do is to start doing some research about the issues that are of interest to her or him and how to learn more. There's a great deal of information that can be obtained. And one has to be aware that this information is widely accessible. But I think the problem is that there isn't sufficient civic education right now. And that's been touched on by EJ and María Teresa as well. Anyway.
EJ, 1 minute.
A few quick things. One, I agree ranked choice voting would be very good for a whole bunch of reasons. Australia does it in conjunction with universal voting. One, finance. Make sure your election board is financed. One of the reasons for those long lines is we don't have enough polling places. We don't have enough election workers. And the last thing voters tend to want to finance, are you going to pick the schools or the election boards? We got to finance our elections properly. Two, make sure the people elected who run elections, secretaries of state in states that have them, or in some places, there are local voting boards. Make sure those people want an honest count. I am not here, by the way, making a partisan count. One of the heartening things about 2020 is there are a bunch of Republicans out there, Republican election officials who ran good elections and wanted an honest count. But make sure that people who are going to rig the count and are saying so openly don't get elected to those things. Three, volunteer to work the polls. And my sister is head of the board of elections, the board of canvassers in her town. She's gone into the high schools to recruit a whole new generation of poll workers and to pay them, which high school students can use. I think volunteer work in the polls. Fourth, help people who face voter suppression measures to get around them, whether it's voter ID laws or other things making it harder for them to vote. Those four things could help. And thank you for being willing to do it.
And María Teresa.
I want to remind everybody that our job is to rinse and repeat 2020. And had we had this conversation in November of last year, I would have been less optimistic. But the good news is that a lot of the congressional maps that we were concerned with, that they were going to be heavily gerrymandered, they have been thrown into the courts and the courts have washed them and said, no, you cannot actually gerrymander communities of color like you intended to. So most of our maps are safe. That's not to say that Texas is out of the woods yet. Full disclosure, Voto Latino is suing the state of Texas, but so is the DOJ, and the same is in Arizona. But for the most part, there is a rinse and repeat, meaning that we want to make sure that even though it's a midterm election, we want the same level of enthusiasm that we saw in 2018 at minimum. That means what you can do as an ordinary citizen is volunteer to be a poll worker, but you can volunteer at votolatino.org. And I will tell you, we have roughly about 7,500 volunteers. And in 2020, those 7,500 volunteers contacted 3.7 million low propensity voters and got them to the polls. We also worked very closely with the lawyers committee so that if people are having access to the polls issues, that we can actually file and make sure that they have all the information they need to make sure that they can ensure their ballot. And more importantly, make sure that you're having friends and family pledging you that they're going to go participate. Because again, it is rinse and repeat.
There you have it. We have an incredible panel of people who have fully embraced the responsibility to make sure everybody has access to their right to vote. We are so grateful to you for your leadership example. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I will pass it over to David Oxtoby.
Let me thank all of you, EJ, María Teresa, John, and Danielle, for your time and your insights today and for all that you are doing and have done in service to our democracy. This concludes the 2106th Stated Meeting of the American Academy.